If you're waiting to be punished, Jesus was already punished. Your sin was already condemned in his body. Your sickness was nailed to that cross. Your poverty was nailed to that cross. Your fear was nailed to that cross. Your defeat was turned into victory on that cross. Your mistakes were paid for on that cross. And today, you have a blood-bought right to a victory in every area of your life because Jesus Christ of Nazareth was your substitute. Hallelujah.
Welcome to Get Understanding with Ramson and Estrella Mumba.
Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6. We are talking about making room for more. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is what? Given. Now check out what's going to happen. The government. Somebody say out the government. So we're talking about rulership and dominion. Rulership and dominion. The government shall be where? Upon his what? Shoulders. And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Now, next verse. Check this out. And look at this. Verse 7. And of the increase. Somebody say increase.
Increase.
Okay. Of the increase of his what? Government and peace. There shall be, there will be no end. And upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even what? Forevermore. Now check out what would do this. And the zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. It will perform it. So here is a messianic prophecy that we read all the time at Christmas, and you know, you got on your Christmas card, and every child knows this verse. But notice what it really was talking about concerning the assignment of Jesus. The government shall be upon his shoulders. Now, that government will be on his shoulders. The government will be on his shoulders. The government is on his shoulders. We are the body of Christ. Yeah. Ephesians tells us that Jesus is the head, but the government shall be upon his shoulders. You all leave me alone yet. Okay, follow me. So, check this out. The government shall be upon his shoulder. He's the head. We are the body. Yeah. The shoulders are in the body. Yeah. The government shall be on the body. The governing authority that God is going to leave on the earth is the church. Yes. Yes. If we had time, maybe we will have time over the course of these several weeks. You know why the Antichrist cannot be revealed? Because we're here. The Bible says that the church restrains him. Just like Noah escaped the antediluvian age, the floods, come on somebody, and until Noah got into the ark, it never started raining. Until the church is raptured, there will be no tribulation. We'll get into that. But it is the church that restrains the enemy. The reason the enemy hasn't taken over, the sinners ought to be glad that Christians are around. Because if you pull out the church, then evil will be unrestrained. And so the government is upon his shoulders. Go to the book of Daniel. I want to show you another prophecy concerning eschatology. Daniel chapter 2. And I want to read verse 44 because we have to notice a couple of things. Daniel, the prophet Daniel, one of the major prophets. This is the vision that Nebuchadnezzar had, but Daniel is giving the interpretation. And in the days of those kings, the God of heaven, in the days when we have had all these five empires, and now you know we are in the fifth one, right? Yeah. We can talk about that and go in detail. But check this out. And he gave this to Nebuchadnezzar, a Babylonian king, present day Iraq. Come on, somebody. Okay, we will leave that alone. So, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom in those days. that shall never be what? Destroyed. Now, please notice what God is setting up. What is God setting up?
A kingdom.
Talk back to me. What is God setting up?
A kingdom.
So God is setting up a kingdom. Jesus is building the church, but God is setting up a kingdom. Two different things. The kingdom is the whole picture. The church is a subset or a vehicle for bringing about the kingdom. But the end is the kingdom. The church is the means to bringing about the kingdom. So if we then make the church the whole picture, then we've missed the whole point. That's like, some theologians who don't study, or actually it's not even studying, it's just showing your intellectual ineptitude, and, you know, you are being lazy to not rightly dividing the word. When the Bible says, you know, the harvest is plentiful, and but the laborers are few, and then pray that the Lord of harvest, come on somebody, would send laborers. And they say, well, look at the next thing. As soon as he said the harvest is ready, the next word he said was what? Pray. And they just think it's time to pray. No, it's not just time to pray. Praying is not the end. Praying is the means to releasing the desired outcome, which is that we may have more laborers. In fact, if you are praying about something and you don't start doing it, you shouldn't be praying. Because you are not operating kingdom principles. The only way God will call you to pray about something is to make you part of the solution. The reason some people who don't understand their calling end up being critical is because whatever moves you and you see other people not doing it right, you criticize them because you are anointed to do it right. The reason you feel like they can do better is because you know better and you should be doing better. But because you're not doing it, the next best thing to that is what? Criticism. So if you keep praying about something, you are not a real intercessor if you don't move out to do what you're praying about. I'm going to leave you alone. Yeah, and you see, somebody was, well, Robson, no, you just think you can do whatever you want to do without asking anybody. And I said, see, the difference between Robson and Star and El Shaddai Global and the rest of you is that we do what you're praying about and what you're thinking about. While you're praying and you're thinking, we are out there. While there are committees in denominations deciding on the budgets, come on somebody, on who to send to the nations, they are deciding which nation, we are already there. So somebody say, why? Because the issue is not just to pray. The issue is to become God's instrument in the earth.
Amen.
Paul said it this way, the way I preach in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he said, I preach as if God himself was personally present in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. He said, let him that speak the word speak as one that speaks the oracles of God. But look at this. Give me back the scripture. So Daniel says, in those days, the God of heaven shall set up a kingdom.
Yeah.
A kingdom that can never be ended. I need the scripture back. The God of heaven will set up a kingdom, and notice this, that cannot be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume all the other kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Notice the destiny of what God is doing. God is setting up a kingdom that is set to swallow up the United Nations. Set to swallow up the United States, the United Kingdom, the Republic of South Africa, come on somebody, all of Australia, all of Latin America, any other sovereign state that exists, its destiny is to eventually be swallowed up into the kingdom of God. Thank God for your nation. Thank God for every nation. Thank God for our nation. Thank God for his nation, her nation. But the bottom line is, ladies and gentlemen, the kingdom of God is like a man who took yeast and put it in the dough. Come on, somebody. Now, if you have ever been involved in baking, when you put yeast in that flour, in the dough, it doesn't announce it. Say, whoa, we are changing everything around here. Whoa! But if you leave it in there, slowly but surely, and you try to taste it later.
Come on, you better
it will have changed the very chemical composition of what you started with. That's how the kingdom of God is. There is a secret operation while Wall Street is working. Come on, somebody. While they are getting oil and gas out of the ground and they are refining your automobile and they are dealing with your mutual funds and they are dealing with your education system, there is a secret operation from heaven's vantage point that's going on. And before you know it, like that door, the yeast will have permeated the entire thing and you can't go back. You can't go back. You can't unleaven the bread. You can't change this. Okay. Where we're going is the world can talk about what's going on and how big they are. But in those days, the God of heaven shall set up a kingdom. If we had time, I'd go back to chapter to verse 37 and 34, 37. He talks about you saw the hand or a size of a fist, the size of a man's hand. You saw a stone the size of a man's hand, which was cut without the aid of human hands. Right. And that stone is gonna fill up the entire world. The stone the builders rejected. Okay, I'm going to leave this alone. We got several weeks, so I got to start smaller because I'm taking you somewhere. We're talking about, you know, making room for more. Yeah. Making room for more. The God of heaven is, what's God doing right now? He's making room for more by what? Establishing a kingdom. What's God doing? Establishing a kingdom. What's God doing? Come on. What is God doing? So God's not just building the church. Jesus is building the church, but God is what? Talk back to me. What's God doing? Okay, so if you are church-minded, you are going to be late or out of sync with God's ultimate agenda. Because if you are church-minded, let's just break it down. First of all, you will serve the vision of your pastor. You will be more concerned about your local community. You will be more concerned about you. And what's in it for you. And if it doesn't please you, you will not show up. You will not participate. You will not give because it doesn't serve your interest. It's no different to electing somebody into the White House. Elections are not even so much about what's going to happen. Elections are about whose interest is going to be advanced. You know, if we get a Democrat in there, such and so issues are going to be. If we get a Republican, come on, somebody, this. It's about interest. And so when you begin to the only way you can participate in the kingdom of God is to set aside your agenda. Because it's not building your kingdom. This is big. Let me tell you what is really burning in my heart, and I fully intend to carry this out. For however long I live, I intend to challenge every Christian to recognize that we are a theocracy. We are not a democracy. You see, many people, because we've grown up in a democracy, you know, a government of the people, for the people, and by the people. Come on, somebody. Mm-hmm. We think that God is also going to carry the majority vote in order for him to execute his plan. In the kingdom of God, Theo is king. You know, Theo is God, right? Theo makes the rules, and Theo does everything after the counsel of his own will. Come on, somebody. And notice this, because this robs us, and even the United Kingdom, even though it's a monarchy, it's really a parliamentary democracy. So it's not an ultimate kingdom like it used to be in days of old, back in the days of kings. If it's a real kingdom, the king has to be good to his people. Because how his people live and how they turn out is a reflection not only of his wisdom, but also of his ability to rule with such excellence that is worthy of following. So the thing you have to understand about being in the kingdom of God is God will never take advantage of you. Because if he takes advantage, let me put it another way. If he gives you a raw deal than you would get by yourself, it makes him a bad king. Amen. That's why you can't be broke because he looks bad. Amen. You can't be sick because he looks like a bad dad. You can't be put out because it looks like he can take care of his children. Come on. And yet he's writing in the Bible saying, if a man can take care of his family, he's worse than an infidel. And if God can take care of you, then God is worse than... Okay. Let me leave this alone. Then God is worse than an infidel. He should read his own Bible. Okay, I'm gonna leave this alone. See, when you understand the kingdom mindset, things begin to change, even the way you relate to God. When I'm out there and my wife and I are talking about what God is doing and what God is asking us to do, here is the bottom line. God has to help us. Because for God not to help us is for God not to help himself. Whose kingdom does he think we're building? Our kingdom? He got to show up. When I'm out there believing God to touch somebody, if they release their faith, he got to heal them. He got to give them new hearts. Come on. Okay. Because it's not my name on the line. That's what's wrong with the church today. You start praying about your name. You're worrying about your name. You're worrying about your bills. Come on. Oh, I'm going to tell you. You're worrying about your child. You're worrying about your insurance. You're worried about your health. But when you start worrying about his kingdom, he said you seek first the kingdom of God. Then what? All of these things shall be what? Added unto you. So I got a question for you, ladies and gentlemen. Are you aware of what's going on? Are you aware of what's going on? Or are you just waking up to go to J.P. Morgan Chase to work again? And thank God we should do that. Because I'm going to show you what the agenda is and how to carry it out. Are you aware that while you're raising up those kids, actually, the reason God gave you the privilege to even have a child was that you should replicate and duplicate his nature in somebody? Can I go there? Do you know why ultimately homosexuality is an attack on God's ingenuity? Because if men marry men, there'd be nobody to duplicate the nature. Okay. If women marry women, okay, I'm gonna leave you alone. It's an attempt for the devil to shut down the perpetuity of God's seed in the earth. Even if you adopt somebody else, when you all stop reproducing, who are you gonna be adopting? So when we begin to understand this, you're not trying to be mean. You're just trying to tell people. Everything has an ultimate consequence. For example, because the church won't teach the people the principles of the kingdom of God and that the kingdom is valuable, now the pastor got to come up with gimmicks to get people to give, to get people to church. Yeah. Now I can't just say, come and we'll preach the gospel, unless I say, we'll show you, we'll give you a big TV. You don't even have a reason to invite your friend because there'll be no raffle at this church. But if I'm going to put your name in a hat and shake it all about, and you go around, you know, winning the 65 curve, amen. You don't understand the kingdom agenda. If you don't understand the kingdom of God, now we got church all the time. When they put on a conference, there is a registration fee. Would you like to know what that is? Because the church did not teach the people to value the kingdom, the people would have come to the meeting and not given anything. So instead of letting the pastor be left holding the bag of bills, the pastor just receives the offering up front, calling it a registration fee. Deceiving and being deceived. That's what Paul called that in the last days. Because the people will go and spend $2,000 to look good for the meeting, but come to the meeting and give $10. And talk about they are giving God a favor. Oh, it's getting quiet. We talk about, well, we can't do what God called us to do. We can if we value the kingdom. But if you don't understand what it is, you begin to think, for example, this is not right. This church, Ramson Mumba gone. Paul used to go for 14 years. That's how the gospel got to you. Imagine if he hadn't gone. Where would you and I have been? But, you know, you don't understand the kingdom. So since it's gotten to me and my family, we don't need anybody else. Okay, can you see how we're sounding? Okay, what is God doing right now? Establishing, come on. Talk back to me, what's God doing right now? Okay, this is going to be so amazing. One day, you will be right there in your bed. and you start rising up. That anointing that's going to be on Jesus is going to be so amazing, it will lift you up from the earth. If they put you in a resurrection site somewhere, that's what I like to call, you know, burial. Because I show you a mystery, we will not all fall asleep. But if you do fall asleep, notice we don't even die, we just fall asleep. I'm going to leave you alone. But if we put you in a resurrection site somewhere, there's going to be so much anointing. Imagine the saints. I can trace my family back to 1522. I got a whole family line of where they've been since 1522. Wow. So imagine now my great-great-great-great-grandfather, wherever they laid him to rest. There's going to be so much anointing on Jesus that it will gather all the parts of his decomposed body, because we will meet him in the air bodily. Yeah. You all leave me alone. He's gonna find, if they had built a freeway on the grave and the leg is on that side and the hand is on that side, the anointing on Jesus, he's gonna be so, you leave me alone. He's gonna be so awesome, he'll get all the particles together and slap them together in that twinkling overnight, and we will start to rise again. Do you believe that? Okay, now notice what Paul said. If you believe that, you purify yourself. He said, you set yourself apart. You don't live like the world. You know, if you are serving the church, they preach to you about how to be living good on earth. So I got a question for you. In your church or your reverend or whatever, if you're watching this, are you preparing your congregation for how to live well on earth or how to live in eternity? Because eternity, if you don't know, is like endless. I'm trying to tell you, if you think 50 years is long and you've been suffering for 69 years, wait until there's no end. You know, one of the most weird things that's ever going to happen to the devil? To throw him into the bottomless pit. Now I said, how did God make a bottomless pit? Only God can make a bottomless pit. For 1,000 years. You know your eschatology, right? When Jesus comes and we're caught up in the air, the devil will be taken away and he'll be thrown into the bottomless pit. He will be going down for 1,000 years, but he will never hit bottom. Okay, I'm on. Now imagine this is not even 1,000 years. You know, Christians used to talk about these things, we believe.
Yes, sir.
God is building a kingdom.
Yes.
God is not just paying your bills. This is big. Now, God is not just trying to find you a man.
Come on.
Oh, he'll get you a man. But if you don't attach it to the kingdom purpose, if you don't say, Lord, I need a man so we can go over there and stay for a few weeks or months in that other country, and I won't feel exposed so I can preach the gospel, he'll get you a man tomorrow. He said, it's getting cold. I need a pair of legs. Oh, Jesus. Okay, I'm going to leave you alone. Why you need a wife?
Why?
Why you need a wife? Because you don't need to get saved to get a wife. Amen. Why you need one that will come from God?
Yes.
For kingdom purposes.
Yes. Amen.
Why you need kids? Why do you need to prosper? Why should God give you more money than the other sinner, since both of you are his children. Did you know that sinners are God's children? Did you know that? Some of them are so good that God blesses them better than Christians. I know you don't want to tell the truth. They have more integrity than people who come to church. Okay. So why should God prepare you? Why you? Why should God get so involved in your business?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because notice, in those days, the God of heaven. Go to Hebrews 12 and let me read this. Hebrews 12 and let's begin at 25, because I just need to set this up and then we're going somewhere. The God of heaven. Look at this. This is Hebrews chapter 12 and 25. See that you don't refuse him who speaks, talking about, you know, in the provocation when they did. For if they did not escape, who refused him, who spoke on earth, much more shall we not escape if we turn away from him who speaks from heaven. Next verse. whose voice shook the earth, but now he has promised, saying, look at what's coming. Yet once again, I will not only shake the earth, but also heaven. Yes. Next verse. Somebody say there's a shaking coming. Mm-hmm. Now this yet once more indicates the removal of things that are being shaken. So everything, ladies and gentlemen, that can be shaken is going to be shaken. And you build your whole life on getting the big house, and the big house can be shaken. You build your whole career and your whole life on impressing other people. Stuff that can be shaken. He said, it indicates that anything that can be shaken as of things that are made. So everything that is made shall be shaken. Lord have mercy. That the things which cannot be shaken may remain. Now, the other day, I can talk freely, right?
Yeah.
I got all these suits, you know, made, and because I've been the same size for all these years, I dry clean them and I pack them in suit carriers. And every so often I feel like wearing one of them, amen. Yeah. I got, you know, put it on. The other day, one of my favorite suits, and I have this thing where if I like something, I don't wear it too many times. I don't know why. Maybe I think it'll last long. The other day, I wanted to wear a suit that I haven't worn for about 4 years. I really like it. I unzipped it. It's been dry cleaned. Nobody has touched it. It's been in my closet. The last time I saw it, it looked brand spanking new. Without anything, it's got moth holes. I said, isn't this just like creation? Everything decays.
Right.
Yes, sir. Nobody even touched the suit.
Right.
This suit should be so excited, she's been packed properly. Come on, somebody. But she goes to fall apart. Okay. But imagine leaving your car outside. Just leave it there for 10 years.
Yeah.
Everything that can be shaken. Just leave your arm there and not do anything with it. Or even use it for 50 years and see if it looks as smooth as it was when you were 15. Everything is journeying south. Hello, somebody. Okay, I'm only you alone. You don't need me to preach a sermon to you to know that everything that can be shaken. Some of you, this is shaking, this is shaking, this is shaking. Yeah. It's all shaking. I rest my case. Just tell somebody it's shaking right now. Stop me shaking without permission. Praise the Lord. So he says, give me the script. I think we better go back to the word. So he said, everything that only things that cannot be shaken will remain. Now the question is, what are the things that can't be shaken? The flower fades, Isaiah 40, verse 6. And, you know, through to 8. The flower fades, the grass withers, but only the word of the Lord shall stand forever. So the only thing that shall never be shaken is the word and the kingdom. Everything else from my body to your body, come on somebody, your teeth, amen. It all shakes. Amen. So here is the deal. Are you going to spend your whole life on things that shake? How about in the natural? Would you really go and build a house on shaky ground and say, I'm putting my foundation here? So why are we doing this with our lives? You take your whole life and you stake it on what shakes. One of the worst things the devil can do to you is to make you a natural man, a natural human being. To forget that we are citizens of another world. Because Peter said it this way, seeing therefore that all these things will melt, what manner of men ought we to be? In other words, in the light of the fact that there is an eternity, how shall we live right now? And the saddest part is, there are very few people who are hearing this in church. It's like trying to prepare people, you know, for the wedding instead of preparing them for the marriage. You know the difference, right? You can be so ready for the wedding. Everything is peachy king. I mean, you got the finest china and everything. Gold. Everybody looking good for the wedding. But you know that after the wedding comes the... And there is no honest person who can tell you that you got married and you just synchronized like that. Every honest person will tell you the first 1, 2 years, or 3 years, depending on how quickly you wise up. Some of you, 10 years, you're still, what? What? Yeah, okay. Come on, yeah. Yeah, I'm telling the truth. I'm just trying to tell you. If you're going through your being processed right now, don't jump. Don't jump. It's common to man. It's common to man. God said they shall become one flesh. That becoming is something else. I'm trying to tell you, it takes a while. But anyways, so now you're ready for the wedding, but not for marriage. The church has been getting ready for the wedding. But the wedding will be a few hours. We're fixing to have an eternity of a marriage with the Lamb of God. Please listen to me. This is so profound where I'm going. You may never even have, you can be saved nowadays. I never heard the way that, you know, when people think about the kingdom of God, many people just think about all the apocalyptic stuff, like we walk on streets of gold and it's going to be amazing. We'll drink Kool-Aid from New Jerusalem fountain, new fruit every month. And that's true. Amen, and in crowns, but you know that when we study the word, and we will, that's what I'm going to do these several weeks, these 2 weeks, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to show you what is happening in heaven. The Lord told me, when you get to Houston, peel off the curtain so they can see what's happening up here. Kind of like, you know, when you were a kid and your mama was doing something for you, but they said, you can't come in here. Or even at Christmas, they got all the presents, said, you can't come in here now. You know, you can't come in here now. Because if you say it nicely, the little kid, while you do, you gotta walk. You can't come in here right now. Amen. Amen. Because the kid sees the bicycle before you're ready to reveal the bicycle. Amen. So God told me to reveal, to just peel off the curtain, to see what heaven is cooking for you. Because sometimes when you don't know, for example, there are people who thought the guy or the girl was going to dump them because they disappeared, and actually the guy was ready searching for a wedding ring. And they are sitting there panicking. Maybe you don't like me enough. He is late because he couldn't find it.
Right.
So you call him, listen, it's over. Okay. You know the pain of miscalculated assumptions.
Yeah.
The church is living with a miscalculated assumption that God is just here building a church. The church is not the end. The kingdom is the end. Back the scripture. Now look at what he's saying. So God is, next verse. So everything that can be shaken will be shaken. And then he said, therefore, okay, now therefore, look at, God is building a kingdom. Now look what we are receiving. He didn't say, since we are receiving what? What are we receiving? What are we receiving? Come on, Jenny. Okay, so we're not receiving a church.
No.
We are receiving what?
A kingdom.
A kingdom. The word kingdom is a composite word. It comes from two words, king and domain. The kingdom is wherever the king is in domain, where his rule is active. And we'll get into that by way of definitions. But what we are receiving is the active rule of God in his domain. We're not receiving a place to preach. We're not receiving a place to hear sermons.
Yes.
We're not receiving a place to be encouraged.
That's right.
This is getting serious. Thank God for encouragement. That is part of what happens when you're in boot camp and when God is taking care of you. But God is not sending the military to training just to be encouraging them. He's training them so they can shoot the enemy. The U.S. Army, the military, are not training soldiers so they can come back to the barracks and eat all the time. or do the drills. Woo! 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 Hello, somebody. No, we do that to prepare for something else. What have you been preparing for? To eat again?
Amen.
To be slain in the spirit again? Feel another unction? Yeah, come on, somebody. We need to ask ourselves. We need to ask ourselves, because maybe some of us as preachers, we may think God is building a place for us to preach, for us to look good and build a big audience so we can get paid more. The Lord said to me the other day, he said, you remember before you answered the call what you would make in a year by not just preaching in El Shaddai, just taking up all the speaking engagements? I said, what? He said, just go back. So one day, because I'm thorough, so I went back to my ledger. I looked at it. By not answering all the speaking engagements every year now, I have given up $600,000 in honorariums. I used to get that. I'm not saying I could. I used to. So this is not, maybe it could happen. It did used to happen. Okay. I already had houses here in the United States while living in London. I had some in Houston, some in Richmond. Come on, somebody. Cinco Ranch, all that kind of thing. I didn't live here. But God asked me, what are we building? A place for you to preach and get paid? Nothing wrong with getting paid. Let me put it another way. There is nobody who's robbing me of those amounts. Would you like to know? It's impossible to give of yourself and sow your life and not get paid for it. It's just a different kind of payment, and it may not be the kind of payment that happens at the same time. But as surely as the Lord lives, before we die, we will see. Okay, come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Okay. It can happen just one day, but the question is, did you do the will of God? Because now we've even changed the definition of success. Today, success is what people are celebrating. Success is not that. Let me finish this and then tell me to go to 1 Corinthians 4, okay? 1 Corinthians 4. Look at this scripture. Look at this. We are receiving a kingdom. That's what we're receiving. We're receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Now look at what we have to do. If we're receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, we need to have grace so that we may serve God acceptably and with reverence and godly fear. People who are receiving a kingdom must have grace to serve God acceptably, in a way that he accepts, not in a way that you accept. In a way, if you know you're receiving a kingdom, I can't say, you go back, read, let me just give you Ephesians, because that might help, because Ephesians and Colossians are two sides of the same coin, right? You know that, right?
Yeah.
Ephesians shows you the church of the Christ, and Colossians shows you the Christ of the church. If you don't read them correctly together, you might not get the right picture. Yeah. So let's just see the church of the Christ, okay? Yeah. When you read Ephesians, notice when it talks about what God wants you to see, he wants you to know the hope of his calling. Yeah. Yes. Many people in church today are asking the hope of my calling. Yeah. Come on, somebody. Yeah. He's talking about his eternal weight of glory, not my eternal weight of glory. So if we're going to serve God acceptably, what is acceptable to God? What is God expecting to get out of this? Let me put it another way. If you read Philippians, Paul said, the thing that drives me, Philippians 3, I believe, from verse 10, he talks about, I want to know that there is a that for which Christ took a hold of me. He said, I am perplexed because I was a murderer. That's what he's saying. I was the chief of sinners. That's what he said. I am the guy who persecuted the church. But I want to know that. What is that? That is, why did you spare my life?
Right.
Why didn't you kill me like everybody else? Why did you turn my heart? Why was I born? I want to know that for which Christ took a hold of me. He said, every Christian ought to be bothered by what God had in mind when he made you or saved you. And that ought to drive you and say, why, when others died when they are drunk, did you make me get home? When others tried to get high, they overdosed and died. But I still made it. I don't even know how I got home, how and what. Come on, somebody else. I want to get a hold of that. I want to get a hold of why a boy born in poverty in Zambia made it all this way.
Yes, sir. Preach.
Why am I in Houston?
Preach.
How come I ended up in the UK? How come I didn't die when they poisoned me? How come I didn't die in the car accident?
Yeah.
When the police came looking for the dead on that freeway.
Yes,
I want to know why. Yes. Why didn't I die? Why did I make it? Why did you pay for my education? Why did that happen? Why did they come for me? Why? Why? Paul said, that bothers me. I want to know why my heart turns this way. Why I weep for humanity when others are just thinking these are just business people and sophisticated people, and I see their empty soul and my heart bleeds for humanity. Why we buy all this sophisticated stuff? Why is my heart just crying for humanity and saying, God, would you? Why won't I just settle for church like everybody else? Because it's easy. I can come up with all kinds of tricks. We can do all the tricks, but why won't my heart let me prostitute the gospel for dishonest gain? Why?
Come on, Pastor.
Why you make me want to stay true to pattern? Because believe me, I've tried monkey tricks in ministry and they just wouldn't sit with my heart. Why did you give me a heart that you turn a different way compared to everybody else? I'm bothered about that. Sometimes I think he punked me. It's true. Sometimes I say, why don't I just go numb like everybody else, not come in here and teach the Bible? Because I could.
No, sir.
You think you read the books? I've read them all. So it's not, you know, I sat next to a man yesterday flying back to from Washington, D.C. He's not even a Christian. And he starts to bring up all these New York best, you know, sellers, business books and stuff like that. I got the books. Yeah. I read the books, but I don't preach those. In the first place, he's so shocked that I know them all. I give him a synopsis of the book, who wrote the book, when they published it. Woo! I said, mm-hmm. Just in case you thought Christians are stupid.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, but why won't my heart just set off to come in and give you a talk? Because I can. Why does my heart weep? Why is it that my heart won't let me stay in this place and in that place, but wants to raise up everybody else and not build a kingdom around me? How about you? I'm asking myself questions, hoping that you will be provoking your own thinking to ask yourself. You know your situation better.
Right.
You know what could have become of you.
Right.
Why are you here?
Yeah.
Why didn't you die?
Come on.
Why didn't they just abuse you and leave you to die, but God helped you anyway? Why did he protect you and raise you up another time? Why did he give you a second chance? Why? When you messed up so badly, but he picked you up again and said, you can stand up again. Why? Why? Because there are some people who went through the same thing and they never got up again. Why did you get up again? Why? Why? I want to know why you preserved my life. Because the curse of living without a purpose is the emptiness of your soul. You can put money in there. You can put sex, drugs, fame, popularity. None of those will ever satisfy the deepest longings of your soul. We must serve God acceptably. We are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. The God of heaven is establishing a kingdom, and we, ladies and gentlemen, what are we doing? Receiving what? What are we doing? Receiving, what are we doing? Receiving a kingdom. Now the issue is, are you open-handed? Because somebody can give you a gift and you reject it. If Philippians, what did I say? 1 Corinthians 4? And then we go into Luke chapter 19, and then we might deal with a couple of these things. I got 4 minutes. Don't worry. Look at this. Let a man, every person, So consider us. This is how we want you to think of us. Now, when I read this, I want you to ask yourself, is this what people think of me? Because Paul says this is how you ought to be thinking of us. Let them so consider us as servants of Christ. And then notice, as what? Stewards of the mysteries of God. In this generation, do you qualify to be in that number? He said, when they think about us, they should consider us servants of Christ and, come on, stewards of what? The secrets. The secrets of God. We handle that stuff on behalf of God in our generation. That's how they should consider us. When they talk about the church, do they see the church as stewards of mysteries of God or stewards of good talks? And just excitement and social enterprise, all good stuff, but they're part of the process and they're not the end in itself. How would you like to be, would you, if we were to say, now, ladies and gentlemen, I give you a steward of God's mysteries, would you with integrity say, that's me? Or would something in you say,
Amen.
Because notice how we should be considered. People who have been given an estate to manage, something precious. A steward is a manager of another's estate. They give you precious things to manage and oversee on their behalf because they trust that you will do what's right with those things. And God said, I'm going to leave my secrets with you. So then he said, in case you don't know how I expect you to be in verse 2, and it is required. It's not a side issue. This is a requirement. If we say in order for you to graduate, you are required to complete these 4 modules, you are not going to graduate if you complete 3. It is required. It is required for you to know how to reverse park before we give you a driving license. You are not going to get a driver's license even if you can drive in a straight line. If you cannot reverse park, it is required by the state of Texas before we sign off saying you got a license for you to know how to do this. So if we are to be considered stewards of the mysteries, come on, secrets, every state, sovereign state, has its own intelligence system. That is a system of gathering information behind the curtain of their rivals or friends so they could retain or indeed have a competitive advantage. And heaven took its secrets and he says, I'm going to give it to you.
Amen.
Now the question is, will heaven make it based on its intelligence society called the church?
Amen.
If this is heaven, CIA and the FBI and the NSA, are we going to be kept safe from terrorism if the church don't even read the manual to know the enemy's playbook? If we don't even know the chemical composition of a shoe bomb and what the dog should sniff for, we don't even know that. We just come into, whoa, how about that? Whoa, did you like that? Whoa, one more party. Stewards. Stewards. Stewards of heaven's mysteries.
Yes.
That's good.
So here's what you did. When you first came to El Shaddai, you messed up. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay. No. You messed up because these words will haunt you forever.
Yes.
You will never go back to being an audience. Even if you try, you wake up one day and you will say to yourself, am I a steward of heaven's mysteries? Am I required to be faithful? Let me tell you why I say that. Jesus said, until I spoke to you, you were guiltless. But after I have spoken to you, now you are held responsible for what you heard. It's one thing not to know. But now you know that God is building a kingdom.
Right.
What kind of church member are you going to be?
Amen.
That's good.
Amen.
We're required. require. So, Luke chapter 19 and verse 11. I hope I'm provoking your thinking. Luke chapter 19 and verse 11, he started giving us what this is about. So the kingdom of God, give me a minute. I want to make sure. 19:11, okay. So as they heard these things, and I could give you the historic context of this. You know, when Jesus was a child, this is an actual thing that happened when Herod died, and Herod Antipas was going to take off. Okay, let me leave that out. So everybody was literally familiar with this. So this is not just an allegory or a metaphor that was without context.
Right.
Everyone in Judea knew that. That's why Judea was a separate kingdom in terms of administration under the Roman Empire. Compared to Samaria, come on somebody, and Jericho.
Right.
Okay, but look, let's go through this because of time. As they heard these things, he spoke another parable. So this is a parable. He said, he was near Jerusalem because they thought the kingdom of God would appear immediately. So here is Jesus, and everybody is now thinking he is not only, you know, the one who is going to liberate Israel from the tyranny of Rome. You know, the Roman Empire, yes. Were in charge, yes. Of the nation of Israel. Come on, somebody. Yes. In the time of Jesus.
Yes.
And the triumphant entry, if you don't know, its natural significance, the reason they laid out, you know, Palm Sunday.
Yes.
Come on, somebody. They laid out branches. They wanted him to be the king that overthrew the Roman Empire and returned the advantage back to the Jews.
Yes.
And then this guy starts talking about he gonna die. That's why Peter rebuked him. Okay, come on, somebody. We thought you were going to be king. Now you're going, what? So they thought, you know, the kingdom would appear immediately. I mean, he's healing the sick. This guy don't even need money. He's feeding thousands.
Right.
He walking on water.
Right.
He rebuking everything. I said, oh, it's on, dude. You know, they saw the kingdom through their lenses. He paying their bills.
Yes, sir.
Come on, somebody, he feeding them. He told them in John 6, you didn't even come to church because you like what I said. You came to church because I fed you.
Right.
I'm going to leave you alone. Okay. So now, the next verse, look at this. So the next verse, he said, in verse 12, we're talking about the kingdom. Therefore, he said, a certain nobleman, Lord have mercy, went into a far country to do what? What did he go to do?
Receive.
What? What was he going to receive? Okay. He went into a far country to receive a kingdom for himself and then to return. So now he's saying to them, look, you think I am actually going to become the king, but actually I'm about to go to a far country.
Yes.
And then I'm going to come back to receive it. Oh, he said, I'm going to come back to receive a kingdom after you receive the kingdom. We just read Hebrews.
Yeah.
We are receiving a kingdom.
Right.
We receive the kingdom before he comes to receive the kingdom. If we had time, you go read Romans. I mean, 1 Corinthians 15. There's going to be a transaction. This is an amazing thing. When death, which is a physical substance, has been swallowed up of life and it's been thrown into the lake of fire, death will be physically taken up and thrown into the lake of fire. And Jesus will receive the kingdom. The kingdom will be in Jesus' hands. Then Jesus will take the kingdom and give it to the Father. These are profound mysteries. There will be physical exchanges and steps. Okay, you should read this Bible. It's amazing. It's amazing. The whole earth will be rolled up like a blanket, like a garment. And that's where all your assets were. And they just roll it up like my old jacket. Come on, somebody. Because everything that can shake, come on, will be shaken so that only things that cannot shake will remain. So now he went, he said, no, I'm not going to become a king. I'm actually going to go to a far country. And then I will return. But in the meantime, here is what I'm doing. Next verse. So he called the 10 of his servants and delivered to them 10 minas. Little tiny bits of money. Which in today's terms, adjusting for inflation, would be no more than between $10 and $30. He didn't give them much. He purposefully didn't give them something so outstanding for which they would feel legitimized to leave their important things. He gave them things that looked insignificant, that if you didn't know that the oak tree was in the acorn, you would throw away the acorn. I'm gonna leave this alone, I'm not ready yet. But you were looking for the oak tree, but he gave you an acorn. He didn't give you the managing director's job. He gave you an entry into college. But you didn't see the education as the entry into being the CEO or the CFO. You threw away your college days. Now you can't be the CEO. Okay. I'm going to leave this alone. So now this is big. This is amazing, y'all. So he said, he delivered to them, 10 minus, and he said to them, do business till I come. Do business. The 1611 says, occupy till I come. Yeah. Tell your neighbor, do business. So notice God is a businessman. Yes, sir. He's wanting a return. Yes, sir. Now the question becomes, if he said we are to do business, are we doing business? When's the last time you did kingdom business?
Amen.
And made it your business? Because you'll be amazed how many people say, my business is a Christian business. But just because you got John 3:16 on it, but don't tithe. you printed on that. Jesus wept. He weeping over my 9 customers. It's not a business. That belongs to God.
Amen.
Does God have checking privileges? Can he tell you to write the check from the company? And you do it? Or does he even have to ask Gabriel to nudge your heart? He said, I am coming to receive a kingdom, but I first have to go to a far country, which is sit at the right hand of majesty, till he makes all my enemies my footstool. Okay, I'm going to leave this alone. The Lord said to my Lord, that's Psalm 110. That is the seer David saying, the Lord God said to my Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord said to my Lord. Jehovah said to my Lord Jesus, you sit at my right hand. This is big. You know why Jesus could die? Because God and him in eternity came into a conference and God promised him, if you die, I will make sure that you don't die in vain. I will redeem for you a people. That's why, whether or not you know it, some of us are concerned about the fulfillment of that prophecy.
Yes.
Will the Lamb of God receive the reward of his suffering? Because God promised him. That's why I don't care if they are Islamic and they're shutting out the Bible, God's word and his promise to his son is far superior to any humanistic philosophy. There's still going to be a multitude to stand before God from every nation, every tribe, every tongue. Come on. Oh, you are more. Hallelujah. If you think the church is going to lose, you don't know what God said to his son. He said, do business. So is the church doing God's business or is it doing its business? Just selling the oil. And the t-shirts and the wristbands. Come on, somebody. And the raffle tickets. Why you want another building? So you can have bigger offerings? Because the people you've already got in the church are not disciples anyway. I know they're not disciples because they do not have the disciplines of their master. Jesus was so shrewd. He didn't say, go and make followers. He said, disciples. You could not mistake the word disciple for anything else. A disciple, the only way somebody becomes a disciple is you can watch them walking in the same disciplines as their master. Amen. Not attending meetings or singing hallelujah, kumbaya. No. It's like Philip saying to him in John chapter 12, show us the Father. First of all, he's exasperated. Come on, somebody. He's ticked off. He says, I've been with you so long. You're still asking me to show you the Father.
Right.
If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Can the church say that? Because that's the prophecy of Isaiah. Isaiah lamented. He said, how could God allow a young man to die in his prime, Jesus? He was cut off from the land of the living. And who will declare his generation? That's what Isaiah said. He said it's an injustice to kill a young man at 33. With his entire life ahead of him. How could God, who said, I have longevity for you, then cut off his own son? What's the answer to that question? Otherwise, God is not fulfilling his own word. Is Jesus going to be a man who died and only lived 33, or does he have a future? That's the question. And Isaiah answered it. He said, his seed shall prolong his day. Oh, I'm going to leave you alone. I'm going to leave you alone. He said the devil thought he would die at 33. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to raise up somebody to do his 34th year. Somebody else to, come on, somebody. 2,000 years later, woo, he's still alive in us. Hallelujah. He's more alive in us. It's not an injustice that he died at 33. He's still alive. Okay. I'm going to stop. So that's the, you know, I told you Christianity is not a change life, right? It's an exchange life. It's the privilege to live another man's life. It's your turn to take the baton and take this relay race to the next generation. Now, if we give you the baton and you sit in your chair, what's going to happen to his 2016th year? Because nobody ran this lap.
Yes, sir.
Hello, Christian. This is kingdom talk. It's not for babies. In case you don't know the thinking and the revelation that informs me to be on that aeroplane, the last time I was here, I came to Houston for less than 24 hours. I arrived at 2 p.m. I left at 10. I was flying from Tuesday till Friday only to see you once. And not be at home for more than 24 hours. This is the thinking that gets a man up on that aeroplane, because there is a man whose life also was never completed. He was cut off. Oh, come on, somebody. So that we, his seed, may prolong his day. You are so strategic to the plan of God. Don't let the enemy minimize your life just because you don't drive the car, you don't live in the neighborhood, or you don't have this and you don't. That those are the externals. There is a bigger agenda. In those days, in these days, come on, the God of heaven, what's he doing? He's establishing a kingdom. And in these days, what are we doing? We are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. So we have to receive grace to serve. Acceptably. Would you give the Lord a hand of praise? Hallelujah. That's what's going on. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to tell you that I apologize for not being the kind of pastor you know. But I would be doing the architect of the Christian life at a disservice. I would be doing him a disservice by becoming what you think I should be. And then I would be doing you a disservice by letting you not experience the fullness of his counsel. Because what you know was not right. That's what I'm sorry. What you've known as the kingdom of God is not right.
Yes, sir. That's
right. And please let it be my privilege to explain to you the divine design of what God is doing up there.
Yes.
Peel off the curtain and say, he will pay your bill because he wants you out there. He will heal you because sick people can't go. He will make your family work because people who are disgruntled and all upset cannot focus on the mission. The things he's doing for you are so you can go. But if you make it about you, then you have minimized your own significance in the equation of his eternal purpose. Because God's burden, the only thing God cares about is his purpose. I hate to tell you that. That's why Christians can't understand who God uses. God will use a fornicator, an adulterer, a thief, a cheat, if that thief will move the kingdom forward. And all the holy people that you know don't even get anointed. God is a manipulator.
Yes.
If he has to raise up a Rahab, because Rahab would be, you know, bold enough to cheat and lie and hide the spies compared to the perfect Jewish women. He'll use Rahab, who's a prostitute.
Yes, sir.
Because God's burden is his purpose, so that there still would be a womb through which his son can come.
Yes, sir.
It's not about you getting Jericho or getting the promised land. It's about somebody moving the ball forward so my son can be born of a virgin. Okay, I'm going to leave you alone. You will never understand God's choices until you understand God's burden.
Amen.
And God's burden is his eternal purpose. You will never understand why even you, with all your issues, God still comes after you. Until you understand that he sees something in you that can move his purpose forward. Okay, I'm going to leave you alone. You will never understand why he keeps holding your family by a shoestring. It should have broken, but he keeps it there because he knows you will move. You're leaving me alone. That's why you can't understand why. Why would he choose Noah? Because Noah wasn't a perfect man.
Yeah.
Noah finished the assignment after 120 years. First of all, he's frustrated. He preached for 120 years. Nobody got saved. 120 years, nobody got saved. What God called him to do took so much out of Noah. By the time Noah got the job done, he was laid up blind, drunk, didn't even know who came in.
Yeah.
Noah wasn't a perfect man.
Yeah.
But Hebrews tells you why God chose him. By faith, Noah moved.
Yeah.
That's it. Being warned of God, he moved. God blesses people who move. Do business. Do something.
Yeah.
Advance. God will bless you. That's why you can't tell your testimony. He even gave you the job when you lied because he needed a Christian there. You didn't say everything correct. You told a lie at the interview. But he still, you lie. You don't want me tonight. I'm trying to tell you. You didn't meet your man at church. That's why you get fuzzy when we talk about the details of what happened. But he knew why you were fornicating, that sooner or later he would turn your heart, and that same man or whatever woman you are will use him for the kingdom. So you can talk about how it began, but you can talk about where he's taking you at. Because he knew, even in your waywardness and your whoremongering, that same prostitute you used to see would become an honorable wife. Oh, you'll leave me alone. You shut your mouth. Okay. You don't want the truth. If you are ready to see what heaven is doing, that's why your cigarettes can't put him off. You still getting high? I don't care about that. I know, I believe so much God in you that even your highness will be weakened and overcome by his purpose. Because here is what God does. He will use you while you're still wicked and twisted and you don't even trust yourself. And then after a while, he's so good to you.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. You can't smoke no more.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
How can I smoke again? How can I lie again? How can I fornicate again? Come on, somebody. The goodness of the Lord will lead you. Come on, somebody, to repentance. Somebody give the Lord a shout in here. Hallelujah. Woo. Glory to God. Stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. So we got a couple of weeks to get down into this. Lest we die as mere men.
Yeah.
Just make our lives about paying bills.
Yeah.
No, we're better than that. Our preoccupation shouldn't just be about your heart. God takes care of us.
Yes, sir. Praise
Bible God. Humility is you getting yourself off your mind. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. 1 Peter 5, that in due time he might what? Raise you up. How do you humble yourself? Casting all your cares upon him. As long as you're taking care of your business, you are proud. But you take care of his business and you let him take care of your business. That's humility. Lift your hands up. Glory. Oh, come on, my baby. Glory. Lift your hands up. Just tell him, Lord, I love you. Turn my heart in the direction of your will. Strengthen me. Give me grace to serve you acceptably. Open my eyes to see what you're doing. I love you because you first loved me. I want to know. I want to get a hold of that for which you took a hold of me. Don't let me die before I see why your hand is on my life, is on my family. I thank you that tonight you have heard my prayer, and I believe I receive fresh grace to operate in a different way. And I give you thanks now because I am not condemned. I receive the ability to move forward and increase your government and your peace, which is on my shoulders. Thank you for the ability to carry this government. I believe I am the man or the woman. Come on, if you're a man, I am the man, I am the woman for the job. And I rest in your wisdom for choosing me with all my weaknesses, all my flaws. None of that stuff moves you. You are not fazed by my insecurities, my inadequacies. Your grace is sufficient for me, and I worship you for such kindness. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Let him finish it. Just take a moment, don't rush. Thank you, Father. Kurayahimo parola mambare. Mbere kaso tori mahaya. Kurapasina moroneke. Tefrovira leke. Semba palamamba baralo sotele moho. Pray in the Holy Ghost, because when you pray in the Holy Ghost, you process the plan of God, just gently. Randa ti palomoho. Sele lili mondonde di buku pala somo. Ravara lende bongru sono boho. Amamba rola mambra dos. Rakando lomoho matele mondo. Ferale mama teleka. Rondo sitara. Randa boko sote. Kila lema mamre nila kela la moho. Santa kara paro. Severe lele mamaralo. Semba roko sandeleke. Sipalo monom na mana leba haya. Amra di sontore maha. Soko. Soto. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. The Lord asked me this afternoon to ask him on your behalf. And if you open your heart, you would receive it. He asked me to ask him to let you feel his heartbeat. From now on, he would synchronize your heart, your desires, your passions with his purpose. So, Lord, in obedience to your word, it's a simple prayer. Could we feel your heart from now on? May we have the same passion, the same desire. You said you would turn our hearts in the direction of your will. Because even the heart of the king is in the Lord's hands, and you can turn it like a watercourse. Every place where we have had a different focus, different priorities, different understanding, turn our hearts, turn our values, turn our passions. For sure, because you're a good dad, you're not going to shortchange us in this life. For there is no man that has ever left house, mother, father, brother, sisters, land, or anything in this life for the kingdom, for the gospel, who will not receive in this life 100-fold. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Go ahead and thank him that you receive it. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Bless your name. Bless your name. Bless your name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. May the grace of God come on you, so that you and I, together, we as a family, El Shaddai Global, may serve God acceptably in our generation. We give you praise. We give you glory. In Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.
Amen.
Come on, clap those hands and give the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. I sense a shift. I sense a shift in the Holy Ghost. Do you sense that tonight? There is a shift. Please take your seats. Let's honor the Lord. Let's value the kingdom. That's what that means. If you need an envelope, just raise your hands. We are going to go, but this is our kingdom. Everybody else sponsoring their things. Sponsoring cigarettes, sponsoring Budweiser. Come on, somebody. Let's sponsor our kingdom. Let's honor and value. We are stewards. All that exploded in my spirit. We are stewards of the mysteries of God. That's how they should consider us. We are stewards of God's finances.
Yes, sir.
I declare we have a church of tithers and givers. I mean, you're not voting with your dollars because you know better than that. We serve God acceptably. Come on. We sow. You know that if this kingdom is going to be established, it's not just in my backyard. I thank God for your faithfulness. And we know that God honors your faith. That's why he will promote you. That's why he will prefer you and say, give them another bonus. Give them another promotion so they can make an extra 10,000. Come on, somebody. Why? Because he knows you are going to sponsor the kingdom.
Amen. Yes, sir.
I promise you, the Lord told me there's going to be prosperity. That's going to break out over the next 6 months towards the end of the year. I mean, beyond what you can ask or think. Come on, somebody. But he said, now tell them to watch. Whoever's assignment is connected to the kingdom, they will rise higher.
Amen. Amen.
Whoever says, I want to increase because I will promote the kingdom, they will rise quick. You won't have to compete with the sinners. You won't have to interview at the same time. No, they will headhunt you.
Amen.
While they're looking for jobs, you will get another one. Come on, somebody. Oh, hallelujah. If there is no honor in your offering, time to change it.
Yes, sir.
If it's a tip, our God is too big for a tip. Amen. It's getting quiet.
Yes, sir.
No, our God deserves substance. We honor the Lord with our substance. I don't even trust a man or a woman who don't tithe. The person who can rob God, don't marry him. He can rob you. I'm telling you right now. These are character indicators. Oh, no, 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 no. A person who can think they can get away with, no, 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 no. If I forget, my wife's like, have we got our offering? If she forget, baby, did we take? Mm-hmm. You know why? because it's our responsibility to sharpen one another as iron sharpens iron. And you honor God, it doesn't even become a chore. People don't understand what God is doing. They're fussing about dollars when God is trying to get us a whole kingdom. Oh, man. You ready? Praise the Lord. I suppose we might as well stand up. Otherwise, we'll keep talking. Tomorrow night, I'm there in the north. If you want a second dose, if you thought you heard it, it will come back. It will come out differently tomorrow. Because this is not a speech. I'm not going to say the same thing, the same joke at the same time and laugh or cry. No, this is the different people in the audience. So the Holy Ghost orchestrates it differently. And we just flow with the Holy Ghost. Some of you, here's what you need to do. Develop a hunger for God. Just try it. Say for 6 months, wherever things are happening, I'm going to be there. I'm telling you, your whole life will change. Many people don't break through because they don't even know when opportunity came knocking. Did you know that every person is a door to another world? Did you know that in the church, your man and woman of God are a door to a new world?
That's right.
If you want to enter a different world, some of you can't enter it. You are too far. Hang closer. In other words, just show up. 90% of winning in life is showing up. I guarantee you tonight, if you don't even believe this in church, start showing up at the Rotary Club. Just show up at every meeting. In 6 months, if you show up every meeting, within a year, you will be part of the committee to run it. Before, if you keep showing up, you will run it before 2 years is up. It's the way it works. Many people don't succeed because they've never given their whole self to anything.
Amen.
Your whole self. Just throw your whole self at your studies. You didn't fail because you're not smart. No, you failed because you were not all there.
Amen.
We're going to sit down. Pastor Leroy, come on up because I'm going to be talking. I love you.
Thank you for watching Get Understanding with Ramson and Estrella Mumba. This broadcast has been made possible by friends, partners, and viewers like you in this area. We trust that you've been blessed and thank you in advance for your continued prayers and generous financial support. For information about our ministries or to download our free podcasts, visit us at www.elshaddaitoday.com.